Thank you. So first, let me thank the organizer of this workshop. It's a great pleasure to be here. So I'm going to talk indeed about backpropagation, and all this is joint work with my colleague Jérôme Bolt, who is also from Toulouse. So first thing, why is there anything that we need to understand about backpropagation? What is the problem with it? It's a mature technology. It's implemented in many softwares. The main idea is that we don't really have calculus for non-smooth objects, and I will first highlight this issue and then introduce a notion of conservativity which catches some of the problems that we have here. But first, what is backpropagation? So it's an instance of automatic differentiation, and this is an automatized application of the rules of differential calculus. And so if you have a function in the form of a composition like this, and if everybody is smooth, you may compute its gradient by simply multiplying Jacobians evaluated at proper points, and also use the fact that the Jacobian of a function is simply the gradient transpose. Given this, numerations came up with an abstraction which captures the fact that a program implements a function by combining smooth elementary operations, smooth elementary function in a smooth way. Okay, so a program computes a composition like this, essentially by computing all the intermediate steps and outputs the last one. With this abstraction, you may use the knowledge of derivative of the elementary operations to, in addition, compute derivative. And this is what Vincent talked about in his talk. So you have essentially two ways to do it. The forward mode is essentially what you would do with pen and paper if you were computing a derivative by hand. And the backward mode is a bit more advanced. And it's also more computationally efficient. But the two things compute at the end the same thing. It's a gradient. So we have the answer to our question. Backpropagation computes gradients. And so the backpropagation is essentially the backward mode of automatic differentiation for training of neural nets. Okay, so everything here stands provided that all the elementary steps that we have here are smooth function, at least differentiable. So let's fix a bit the notation regarding neural nets. So they are organized in layers. They have this nice compositional structure. And for us, what is important is the connection between consecutive layers is through this composition of an affine map and a nonlinear map, which we call an activation function. And often, it applies coordinate-wise. So if I collect all the weights of my affine map in a big vector, which I call theta, I have a parameterized set of functions. So the input is, let's say, the first layer, and the output is the last layer. And there is an input-output relation with this like formula. And it's parameterized by all the weights of the affine maps. What is training here? So most often, it's performed by empirical risk minimization. I have a finite sample of examples, input-output examples. And I want to tune the parameters of my networks so that the predicted output given by the network is close to the observed output on the sample. And this is most often performed by minimizing this term, which has this nice finite sum structure. So I'm only going to talk about this one. So the situation, of course, is much more complicated than this, but a canonical choice for optimizing this thing is this mini-batch stochastic approximation strategy. So at each step, I don't want to compute a whole sum, so I'm just picking an example at random and performing a gradient step with respect to this one. And what is specific about neural networks in this case is that the gradient here is computed using backpropagation, using automatic differentiation. So it actually doesn't really matter because we know that backpropagation computes gradients, and it doesn't matter how it's computed. What matters is that it's a gradient. But still, this idea of combining automatic differentiation and optimization is at the heart of those numerical softwares, which are extremely successful nowadays. So with this, you can essentially train a neural net without any knowledge in optimization or analysis, without even knowing that you're optimizing something. So it's great. And it actually goes beyond neural nets. So sometimes people talk about differentiable programming. And here there is a very nice semantic trick because differentiable programming may refer to objects which are not differentiable. That's the power of namings. Why is that the case? Because many practitioners use non-smooth activation functions. So the non-linear part which connects two consecutive layers is not smooth. That's maybe the most famous example, which sometimes is called ReLU. It's also known as positive part. It's not differentiable at zero. Also, it's not differentiable. The non-differentiability looks straightforward. Here, it's a convex function, and it looks nice. But there are many more complicated examples. This includes max pooling in convolutional networks, and it goes all the way to sorting layers, which is an operation of taking values of a vector and ordering them in decreasing order, for example. So some people apply automatic differentiation to this kind of things with apparently successful results. So how is it implemented? What does TensorFlow implement on these things? So it's easy. You just need to pretend that you're smooth, to pretend that you're differentiable. You choose a value for the derivative at the non-smooth point. Here it's zero if you use ReLU. You choose it in a certain way, which is more or less arbitrary for me. And then you apply the rules of differential calculus. So you compute as if you had gradients, but just choosing values for the derivative at non-smooth points. So let's look at a few examples. These are taken from TensorFlow. So the orange part is the function, and the blue part is obtained by applying automatic differentiation to the orange part. And the dots here highlight values of the derivative at prescribed arguments. And you see that indeed at non-smooth points, TensorFlow chooses some value for the derivative at zero. So we can play a bit with it. Here I give you two equivalent implementations of the ReLU function. They are equivalent in the sense that they compute the same thing. From a mathematical point of view, they compute ReLU. But from a programming point of view, they are different because the programs that implement the functions are different. And as a result, if I apply automatic differentiation to these things, the value of the derivative at zero is different. Okay, it depends on which function I look. And so this highlights the fact that automatic differentiation does not directly act on functions. It acts on programs which implement functions. Okay, so automatic differentiation is an operation on programs. And if I take two different programs for the same function, in the non-smooth world, I may get different results. And here it all looks fine because everything still is between 0, 1, and 0, 1 is the subgradient of the ReLU function at 0, so it makes sense. But in the non-convex world, I can do much worse, I can do minus. And with this minus here, I guess I get this personal implementation of the 0 function, which computes 0, it's constant, so the output is constantly 0, but if I call automatic differentiation on this thing, it says that the derivative at 0 is 1. And so this is a real numerical example taken from TensorFlow. So the issue here is that this does not correspond to any notion of even generalized derivative. Okay, it cannot be compatible with notions of derivative that we have. And if you push it a bit further, you may use this to modify derivatives of a smooth function computed by automatic differentiation at prescribed set of points in a more or less arbitrary way. And again, the reason for that is that automatic differentiation, backpropagation acts on programs, not on functions. And so in the non-smooth world, different programs may lead to different results. So what's going on here and what are the consequences for optimization? In the convex world, we have calculus for non-smooth objects. In the non-convex world, we don't have it. And this is one example, sum rule. Okay, in the non-convex world, it may hold as an inclusion and this inclusion may be strict. So there are examples for which this inclusion is strict. What are the consequences for optimization? So let's get back to the convex world for a minute. If all my elements here are convex functions, then there is a crucial step in the understanding of this mini-batch stochastic approximation strategy. And the step is as follows. If I take an element of the subdifferential of each function, then the expectation with respect to the uniform choice of the index belongs to the subdifferential of the sum, of the average. This is because sum rules holds with equality. But in the non-convex world, we don't have sum rule. So this may not hold. The expectation may be outside of whatever the notion of subgradient that I choose here. And it could be much worse if I use automatic differentiation. The thing that I get is not a subdifferential. It's something else, which is the output of automatic differentiation and which we need to characterize. So the consequence for optimization is the following. We know how to analyze algorithms which have this form. And this is a step which consists in subgradient plus zero mean noise. So I need an oracle that is able to compute something that is subgradient plus zero mean noise. So that's what we know how to analyze, and you have a nice example in this 2018 paper, which is compatible with the deep learning framework. Okay. But what is implemented in practice is not this, it's something that looks like that, where d index ik is the output of backpropagation, non-smooth backpropagation on some network architecture. So the reason why we ask this question in the title is we need to understand this if we want to recover, I mean to prove or to understand theory behind the stability properties of numerical schemes which look like that. Right, and to be a bit more concrete, we need a mathematical model for non-smooth automatic differentiation. So just to recap, in the smooth world, if I give you a function, you may give me a program which implements the function. And given this program, I may apply automatic differentiation on it, and I get a result, let's call it D. And this D is numerically equivalent to what I would get if I was first differentiating from a formal point of view and then providing a numerical implementation of the gradient. That's result of automatic differentiation. And this breaks down in the non-smooth case, so automatic differentiation applies to a program, but we don't really understand the connection with the original function, and also we don't understand the connection with known notions of generalized derivatives. Okay, so that's the plan. First, I will introduce this notion of conservativity, and then talk about its properties. So conservativity, we introduce it as a notion of generalized derivative, and in order to illustrate it, let's first think about what is a derivative. The first view on derivation is an operation on functions. So for example, here it's a linear operation on functions. And if you take notions of generalized derivative inherited from the variational analysis literature, they all obey this operator point of view. Getting a subgradient is an operation on a function. If I change a function, I get something different. So that's the usual view, but what we propose follows a kind of reverse process. We see derivation as an inverse operation to integration. So it goes as follows. If I give you small f integrable in the sense of Lebesgue, then I can take big f to be one of its primitive, and there is a famous result saying that in this case big f has to be differentiable almost everywhere, and the value of its derivative is small f almost everywhere. Okay. In this case, we say that big F is absolutely continuous. So that's not the original definition of absolute continuity, but it's an equivalent characterization. And if you look at the difference between those two views, the first one is really a map, an application on functions, and the second one, we get a relation between two objects with a whole equivalent class of potential derivatives in L1. Okay. So in particular, if I change the value of small f on a set of Lebesgue measure zero, it doesn't change the value of the integral here, and the relation is preserved. Okay, so we lose the unicity of the derivative. We don't have unicity of this notion of derivatives through this integration process, but in the end, this is what will be helpful to recover the holes that are created by calculus in non-smooth in the non-smooth world. Okay, so what we propose obey more or less this view. So now I need a bit of technical material in order to introduce it. So an absolutely continuous path will be the same, but with p coordinates. Okay, so it's something that it's a path in Rp. It needs to have to be differentiable almost everywhere to have an integrable derivative, and it needs to be the primitive somehow of its like velocity field. The set-valued field is just a function. Here everything will be finite dimensional, so I'm only working on Euclidean spaces. It's a function, but its output is not a vector, it's a subset of a Euclidean space. Examples of such things, the convex subdifferential. If you take a convex function, its subgradient is a set-valued field. There are extensions of the notion of subgradient in the non-convex world, and the one that we will use is Clark's subgradient. So it's widely used in non-smooth, non-convex optimization. I won't have time to go into the details of its definition. There is a lot to say about it. But that's an extension of the convex subgradient in the non-convex world, and both agree in the case of convex functions. I need a notion of continuity for set-valued field, and the one that you use is that of graph closeness. So the graph of a set-valued field is given here, and I want this thing to be closed as a subset of Rp plus Q. The reason why I require this notion of continuity is because in optimization we are producing sequences, but we want to take conclusion about limits. And so in order to do that, we need a connection between what happens on the sequence and what happens on potential limits. And this is done through this notion of continuity. If D was a function that would correspond to usual continuity, and what I need to say is that those things have a closed graph. So the sub-differential that we have here obey this notion of continuity. Okay, so let's talk about conservativity. So D will be a set-valued field, and I will restrict it to have closed graph to follow this notion of continuity, and also I want it to have values which are non-empty and compact. This is part of the definition because I will only consider fields which have these properties. So what is conservativity in this case? It's the property of having a zero circulation, but it has to be adapted to this setting, right? So first we will use absolutely continuous loops as kind of test functions. So an absolutely continuous loop is just a path which is absolutely continuous and which beginning and end are the same. And I want the circulation of my set-valued field D to be zero. So what is the circulation? It's an integral along this loop. This integral is understood in the Lebesgue sense, so you need to work a bit in order to make sure that this is measurable, but it's the case. And essentially, I take the dot product of the velocity field with my generalized derivative V. But since D is set-valued, I need to choose a value in all the possible dot products here, and it's done through this max. It's a bit arbitrary to choose max, but we would have the exact same definition with mean in place of max. So if I was giving you the same definition with the mean, I would get exactly the same notion, and it corresponds to reversing time. And I could also use set-valued integration, but it's more technical. So if you remember physics, this zero circulation property is what was used in order to define potentials of forces which are conservative. Okay, which derive from a potential, and how you define the potential of such fields, it's essentially through integration along paths. So let's do the same. So given the conservative field D, I may define a function f associated to it, and the value of the function at a given x will be given as follows. It's f of zero, the origin, plus the value of the integral of this circulation. Along a path which is absolutely continuous and starts at zero and finishes at x. Okay. So the nice thing here is that the conservativity assumption ensures that this integral does not depend on the path that you choose. If you choose two different paths, you get the same integral. So as a result, the value of f here defined through this process is well-defined and well-defined up to constant. Okay, so essentially the value of f of zero, and in particular, it doesn't depend on the path that I choose. And the vocabulary that we will use here is f is a potential for the conservative field D, and D is a conservative field for f. Whoa. Okay, I lost it. It's coming back, it's back. Okay. So again, I have equivalent definition with mean or with set-valued integration. And property important. By assumption, D is locally bounded. It has compact values and it is continuous. So it is locally bounded. And as a result, you may check that the F that we define through this integration process has to be locally Lipschitz. And so that's one of the differences with the talk of Quentin Berthet from this morning. I'm only considering locally Lipschitz functions. I'm not differentiating things which are not continuous. Examples. If f is C1, then its gradient is a conservative field for f. Okay, so that's a good sanity check. It's not unique. I may define many other conservative fields for C1 functions, and maybe we'll see some examples. If f is convex and locally Lipschitz, then its subdifferential is also a conservative field for f. This is a result from convex analysis. And last remark, which is very important, we don't have conservative fields for all locally Lipschitz functions. And actually, the set of locally Lipschitz functions which do not have conservative field is generic in the set of locally Lipschitz functions in a certain sense. But so this restricts the class of function that we are looking at. Last technical part, an equivalent characterization through chain rule. Okay, so I have defined a notion of conservativity. There is an equivalent characterization of conservativity by looking at the derivative along absolutely continuous path. So D is conservative for F, if and only if, for any gamma which is absolutely continuous, the value of F along the path is differentiable for almost all T, and the value of the derivative is equal to this dot product. And what is specific here is that in this dot product, I may choose any V in D. And in particular, the value of the dot product should not depend on the choice that I make. Okay, so independently of the choice of V, I should get a single value here. So the geometric view here is that the affine span of D of gamma has to be, in a sense, orthogonal to the velocity gamma dot for almost all T, and this has to be true for any absolutely continuous curve gamma. So that's the main practical consequence, let's say, of conservativity. So using this equivalent characterization, we may invoke the result of Davis and colleagues from this FOCM paper. And what they show is that locally Lipschitz functions which are tame satisfy conservativity. In particular, the Clark subdifferential has to be conservative for those locally Lipschitz tame functions. And here there is a new word popping out. It's tame. So I'm not going to tell you what it means, but I'm going to tell you two important things about it. First, tame functions, they constitute a class of well-behaved functions, which are nice from a geometric and topological point of view. And second, in many situations, we have easy sufficient condition to check that the function is tame. Okay, so it's complicated, but there are easy conditions. And I will come back to that afterward. So this is another class of function which admits conservative fields. And these are the Clark subdifferentials. This chain rule will be central in the Lyapunov analysis of mini-batch strategies for optimization, and I will come back to this at the end. Picture, okay, so we had a lot of abstract things. This is how a tame function looks like. So it's non-smooth, but it's non-smooth in a kind of nice way. And if you look at it, it's differentiable almost everywhere. And if you restrict it to the points of non-differentiability, it's non-differentiable, but it still looks nice. Okay, it's, if you restrict it to this edge, for example, intrinsically as a function on the edge, it's somewhat differentiable. I will come back to that. So this notion of conservativity has to be compatible with integration along paths in like the two-dimensional plane here. And in particular, it has to be compatible with integration along those locus of non-smoothness of the function. So that's what conservativity captures on an image, and you had the formal definition before. Okay, properties. So if I take a locally Lipschitz function f and d a conservative field for f, then d has to be equals to the gradient of f almost everywhere. So we know that f is differentiable almost everywhere. That's Rademacher theorem. And this is an additional result. If I have a conservative field for it, then it has to be equal to its gradient almost everywhere. A consequence is that the Clark subdifferential, in this case, if I can exhibit one conservative field for f, then the Clark subdifferential also is conservative, and it has to be included in the convex hull of D. So this identity has to hold pointwise for any x, Clark subdifferential of f is in the convex hull of D. And then in particular, a consequence of that is Fermat rule. Okay, so if I take a local minimum, then it has to comply with this optimality condition, zero in the convex hull of D. So that's nice. That makes a connection with usual notions of generalized derivative. But I want to point out that conservativity here is much stronger than just being a gradient almost everywhere. So if we want to understand what's going on in this automatic differentiation oracle, we need to go beyond gradient almost everywhere, because it's possible to construct set-valued fields which are not gradient almost everywhere. So you have an example here. Which are, sorry, gradient almost everywhere, but not conservative. Okay, so this is gradient almost everywhere, but not conservative. Yes, maybe the most important part. So conservative fields, they are compatible with calculus. And I cannot present in detail what it means because I will need more time. But essentially, they are compatible with the compositional rule of calculus. So let's first see an example of what this means. In the case of sums, so if I have a set of n functions, locally Lipschitz, and their corresponding conservative fields, okay, so each di is conservative for fi, then the sum of di is conservative for the sum of the functions. Okay, and so if you remember the slide in the introduction, we are missing this sum rule in the non-smooth, non-convex world, and this is coming back here through conservativity. So what happens here is that D is not the unique conservative field for F. There are many of them. Okay, so that's something that we lose. We lose unicity of the notion of generalized derivative, but this gives us additional flexibility in order to catch the potential holes in the sum rule here. Okay, this is really what happens. So I'm skipping the proof arguments here, and let's see consequences for backpropagation, for automatic differentiation. If you remember the abstraction in the introduction, we had that a program combines smooth elementary function in a smooth way. You may use the exact same abstraction, but replace smooth by locally Lipschitz. Okay, so a program will combine locally Lipschitz elementary functions in a locally Lipschitz way. So it's the exact same construction, you just use locally Lipschitz instead of smoothness. Okay, now if you want to apply automatic differentiation, you need to say what you use in place of gradients, okay? You have non-smooth objects, so what do you use in place of gradients? What you use in place of gradient will be a conservative field. So for example, if you have a convex function, you may use its subdifferential, okay? And if you take a program which satisfies this, you may apply the exact same backpropagation oracle. So the computation that is performed by backpropagation is the same thing as what you would do in the smooth case. You just replace functions by non-smooth object, and you replace gradients by something which is related to a conservative field. And the output of this automatic differentiation will be a conservative field. So that's a consequence of conservativity. Okay. So this was abstract properties of conservative fields, and let's get back to our original problem. So learning eventually with deep networks. So I have this empirical risk, which is a finite sum. Each element is gi here. Theta is my decision variable. And here I will make an additional assumption on the network, f of theta. So I want the loss function and network and also on the loss. So the loss function has to be univariate. And I want also all the activation functions defined in the network to be univariate. So that's a restriction, okay? I want them to be locally Lipschitz, and I want them to be defined piecewise. So in this case, segment-wise. They are univariate, they are defined segment-wise with finitely many segments. And on each segment, they are defined by a formula which involves polynomials, quotient, exponential, and logarithms. So it could be a bit arbitrary, but I need the restriction that it's continuous, Lipschitz continuous locally, and it's defined piecewise with first order formula and elementary operations. Why do I need this assumption? This is a sufficient condition for tameness. So tameness is coming back here. Okay, if you have a network which satisfies this, then the function g here, but also all the intermediate steps that you need to compute the function g are tame. Okay, so what does it mean to be tame? Tame means definable in a nominal structure. So this is not really self-explanatory. Okay, the meaning of this is not very precise. So this is why I stick to this sufficient condition. Okay, this is easy to check. This is hard to check. Okay, and under this sufficient condition, everything here is tame, whatever tame means, but like well behaved. Fine. So what do we do with this? So our empirical risk is J, and what is implemented in those software is close to the following. For each I, okay, so I will be the summation index in my sum here. For each I will take the I to be a set-valued field from RP to RP, and I want it to be computed by using automatic differentiation on GI. So the oracle does not give me a subgradient, it gives me the output of automatic differentiation. or backpropagation, if you want. The thing is that since some intermediate steps in the computation of GI are not smooth, I need to say what I take in place of the gradient at non-smooth point, and you could use any element of the Clark subgradient in this case. Okay, so for example, if you're using a ReLU, if you're doing ReLU network, this captures this idea of setting ReLU prime of zero being equal to zero, and then implementing the roots of differential calculus with this value for the derivative of zero of ReLU at zero. So with all those DI, I may average them. I get D, and I set the crit, okay, crit G to be the set of points which comply with Fermat rule, which comply with this first order optimality condition that I've introduced. So what do we have here in this case? First, D is conservative for G. Okay, so we already know, I already told you that backpropagation computes things that have the conservativity property. And in particular, it means that you can integrate it along a segment, for example. A segment is absolutely continuous path, so I may integrate it along a segment, and this gives a relation between the output of backpropagation and the objective functions. D is a gradient almost everywhere, but almost everywhere in the context of tame objects means more than just almost everywhere. It means everywhere except on a finite union of smooth manifolds of dimension strictly smaller than P. So the fact that there are smooth manifolds here does not really matter. What matters is that there are objects which have a well-defined notion of dimension, and this dimension is strictly smaller than the dimension of the ambient space, so we essentially don't see them. We have a Morsard theorem, so the set of critical values is finite. Okay, so the set of critical points is the set of points which comply with Fermat rule, with the first order optimality condition, and the image of this set by G is finite. So if you remember convex functions, they have either zero or one critical value, which is the global minimum. Here it's a generalization to the non-convex world. We may have more critical values, but they need to be finite, and this is a tameless assumption. We also have a KL inequality for these things, but for the moment, I'm not sure it's really useful. Okay, so how do we get those results? I'm going to be very quick on this. This is an equivalent characterization of conservativity in the context of tame functions, of well-behaved objects. And essentially, this equivalent characterization captures the fact that a tame function is differentiable almost everywhere, but if I restrict it to non-smooth, the non-smooth locus, it still has desirable differentiability property. Okay, so if I restrict my function to this non-smooth locus, I still have something that is intrinsically differentiable. I have a notion of gradient in the sense of differentiable geometry. And furthermore, this notion of gradient is related to the conservative field that I get by projection formulas. Okay, so I won't say more about it. I want to say more about this. Okay, so this is mini-batch strategy in stochastic optimization. So again, this is my stochastic algorithm. At each iteration, I choose an example, an element of the sum, and I perform a step which is given by this backpropagation oracle. And I want to study the stability properties of this thing. Is it similar to what we have in the smooth case? Okay, so that's indeed the case. I need some assumptions. I want the step size to be not summable, and I want it to go to zero at a certain speed. Okay, so this is technical reason. I'm conditioning on the event that my sequence is bounded. So this is not completely satisfactory for the moment, because I need to condition on this, but still I cannot do much more as of today. So given those two assumptions, we have the following result. We may consider theta to be the set of accumulation points of the sequence. This is a random set because it depends on the whole path of random integers that we choose here. And the result is as follows. Almost surely, this theta is included in the set of critical points of the objective function g. And furthermore, g has to be constant on theta. So that means that g of theta k has to converge to a value which is a critical value. It has to stabilize at the end, and it cannot oscillate until infinity. How do we get this? We leverage the differential inclusion approach of Benaim of Bauer-Sorin. So they essentially did all the work of Lyapunov analysis of algorithms which look like that for under certain assumption on D. And the only thing that we need is to show that the D that we have has satisfied the assumption that they require. And that's indeed the case. Okay, so The D that we have is given by automatic differentiation, so it is conservative. And in particular, it has a chain rule along absolutely continuous curves. So this is required to implement the results. And the second result that we need is Morsard's theorem. Okay, so the set of critical values has to be should not contain intervals. And that's the case here because we have that the set of critical values is finite, so it doesn't contain intervals. And this is a consequence of tameness. Right. So this is kind of the minimal thing that we would like to ask for an optimization algorithm. It's like attracted by a set of points which are critical in a certain sense, and the value of the function is stabilizing at infinity. So it's a bit weak, but even in the differentiable case, we cannot say much more without making additional assumptions on the loss function and the noise that we are considering. Fine, so let's conclude. So let's get back to this picture, okay? We had this nice idea that in the world of smooth functions, automatic differentiation was related to the gradient and to the original function in a straightforward way. This is lost if you consider non-smooth functions here and non-smooth elementary objects that you combine in order to compute J here. So we investigated the relation between the output of automatic differentiation and the original function, as well as relation with notions of generalized derivatives. Okay, so we found out that there is a relation between this D and the original function, which is called conservativity, and a byproduct is that the Clark subdifferential is somehow a minimal conservative field, a minimal object that has to be related to automatic differentiation. And so this is nice, but okay, oh, so the algorithmic consequences is the following. Okay, so this constitutes like first step for a mathematical model for automatic differentiation, and we already have algorithmic consequences in the following form. If you combine mini-batch strategies for training deep networks with this backpropagation oracle, which we don't really know what it does, then we are able to show that the qualitative asymptotic behavior is close to what we would get in the smooth case. So we are attracted by critical points, and the value of the function is converging at infinity. It's stabilizing, it's not oscillating forever. Okay, and I think I will stop here. Let me thank you for listening, and I can try to answer questions if you have some.